Thank you. I would ask those members who are leaving the chamber to please do so quickly and quietly. The final item of business is a members' business debate on motion 7412 in the name of Megan Gallagher on future of childcare. This debate will be concluded without any questions being put, and I would ask those members who would wish to speak in the debate to please press the request to speak buttons. And I call on Megan Gallagher to open the debate. Up to 7 minutes, please, Ms Gallagher.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Good early years education is fundamental for developing vital skills that will help children succeed in life. Promoting, developing and nurturing these skills, along with strengthening families, are important ways to improve long-term outcomes for children. Research shows the development of important emotional, cognitive and behavioural skills take place early in life. These foundational skills are not only important for a successful transition to primary school, but for later academic achievement and social adjustment. Giving our children the best start in life should be a priority for every MSP that sits in this chamber. Yeah. I am passionate about early years education, and it is one of the many reasons that I got involved in politics. I want Scotland to be the leader in early years by supporting parents and giving our young people the tools they need to achieve. However, the reality in Scotland today is that 1,140 hours is failing our children, parents and private, voluntary and independent sector. The Scottish Government is facing a crisis on top of a crisis. Parents not being able to choose which nursery their child attends. PVI nurseries closing their doors. Staffing shortages, reduction in childminders, out-of-date systems, relationship breakdowns and nursery owners not knowing if they can afford to stay in the childcare sector. All of these are happening under the watch of this Scottish Government. Since returning from maternity leave, I have been in contact with nurseries, charities and organisations who have raised concerns over the Government's handling of the childcare crisis. The SNP has a responsibility to make sure this policy works for parents and their children. If free childcare cannot be delivered, it will result in a worse start in their early years for education. Parents will be unable to work because they cannot get the childcare that this SNP government promised them. I had hoped that during my maternity leave, things would have improved, that the government would finally get to grips with the problems that I and others have been raising for years. But nothing has changed. A former nursery owner in Aberdeen told me that she just couldn't take it anymore. She has now sold her nursery and left the sector completely. Modern apprentices in South Lanarkshire are being paid more than fully qualified childcare practitioners, but the private, voluntary and independent sector is still expected to train and not retain. In North Lanarkshire, a legal dispute has delayed parents from being able to access childcare. Parents are now in limbo as to when they can book nursery places for later this year. And in another council, the PVI sector were told that they were no longer partners, but contractors. The PVI is at the end of their tether, and the silence coming from this government over 1140 is deafening. We have been told that reviews are underway, but no statement has been made to this Parliament recently on early years education. Reviews should lead into action. Action should result in change. So where is this change? The disparity of rates between local authorities and the PVI sector has existed for as long as the 1140 hours policy. It is widely known that local authorities determine what proportion of early years funding the PVI sector receive, and we know that local authorities get more money per child than their competitors. Parents have a right to know why a child that attends a PVI nursery is apparently worth less than a child in a local authority setting. Certainly.
Claire Hawkey, Minister.
Thanks very much. Appreciate Megan Gallagher allowing me to make an intervention. So does she recognise that local authorities are not only service providers, that they have a legal duty to ensure every eligible child is able to access the statutory entitlement to funded ELC, including where it's not automatically or not commercially viable for PVI providers, and that the funding that they get also provides funding for additional support needs, paying for the provision of equity and excellence leads, providing funding for meals in early learning settings, and make provision for crisis support, including for families from Ukraine?
Megan Gallagher.
Well, as a rebuttal to the Minister, I would like to ask her, how can a local authority be a banker and a competitor at the same time. That is the fundamental flaw of the 1140 hours policy. The government has effectively created a policy that allows councils to mark their own homework and set their own rates. And as we know, they're not setting sustainable rates. Disparity of rates across the country is having a huge financial impact on the PVI sector, and it flies in the face of this government's own 1140-hour policy, which states that sustainable rates should include the ability to generate a surplus. But because of this policy, PVI nurseries can't generate any surplus because the government has removed the competition from the market. And it's not just the inequity of rates that has led to this crisis. There has been a complete relationship breakdown between councils and nursery owners. And this has played out in council chambers, where issues have been raised time and time again about the state of early years education. Parents have contacted councillors saying that they can't access their first, second or third nursery choice. The whole point of this policy is to give parents choice. But then we have had councils refuse to meet with nurseries as there's been tension over the delivery of the policy. And instead of trying to resolve the issues, this government has sat back and let it happen. I've had countless conversations with the PVI sector about the lack of partnership working from councils, and I have mentioned earlier how they've been treated, and it has led to the PVI sector feeling completely disillusioned. In July 2022, I submitted a written question about the Ipsos Moray survey. And within your response, Minister, you stated that the guidance is clear that the findings of the cost collection exercise are only part of the rate-setting process, and local authorities will also consider local ELC market conditions and an ongoing consultation with providers. But we know that many nurseries did not fill this survey in. And we also know that local authorities determine around 70% of PVI finances, so there is little room to grow, for nurseries to grow their business. No, I'm in my final minute and I've got more to say. Presiding Officer, 1140 hours is a mess. This SNP government has reviewed the policy time and time again with no meaningful change. While they choose not to act, childminders leave the profession and nurseries close. Parents have been promised 1140 hours of free childcare and they expect this government to deliver it. Should the Minister ignore the concerns that MSPs will raise today, this vital policy will fail. My debate tonight is called the Future of Childcare, and it is time that this government gets to grip the crisis that's in our childcare sector before it is too late. So I'll finish by welcoming the Minister's contribution later on and how this government intends to fix the mess that they have created. Thank you.
Thank you, Ms Gallagher. I now call Alistair Allen to be followed by Ros McCall. Up to 4 minutes, please, Dr Allen.
Thank you, Presiding Officer, and I thank Megan Gallagher for bringing this debate to the Chamber. As I think we can all agree, the first few years of a child's life are, of course, instrumental for their development and for shaping their potential. So parents and caregivers need to be supported in creating a nurturing environment, both in the home and also through access to high-quality, affordable childcare. Now, the Scottish Government does continue to demonstrate its commitment to achieving these aims, not least through things like deferral, the successful baby box scheme, free school meals for all primary schools, and the expansion of funded early learning and childcare. The SNP Government inherited a system, and this wasn't mentioned earlier, that delivered just 412 hours of childcare. But now over 83,000 children in Scotland are accessing 1,140 hours of high-quality funded ELC. And my understanding is that that represents 87% of children. Now, that's not to be complacent, but I think it does put into some context a little bit of what's just gone before in this debate. It is vital that we do continue to work, however, towards creating a society where all parents have a genuine choice about how their families will balance employment and caring duties. As well as benefiting families, our wider economy will also reap the rewards if we do that. A recent study in Quebec found that for every dollar there invested in childcare infrastructure, the economy benefited by up to $2.80 in increased employment. And that's why the Scottish Government's commitment to continuing to expand funded early learning and childcare is so vital for Scotland's long-term prosperity. It is right that we are ambitious in our vision for Scotland's childcare, and all types of provider have key roles to play. Now, the motion for today's debate rightly highlights the damaging impact of the COVID-19 pandemic on the childcare sector, but also cites the growth of the local authority sector and claims that is the reason for what it calls a childcare crisis. Now, in the view of the National Day Nurseries Association. However, the growth of the local authority sector has been instrumental in expanding access to childcare for all eligible preschool children, irrespective of their circumstances. And again, I think that has to be acknowledged.
Megan Gallagher.
I thank the member for giving way. Does the member not realise that by the local authority having control of the sustainable rates for the PVI sector, it's creating a fundamental flaw in the policy, because the PVI sector can't compete against the local authorities? And does the member also agree that the funding formula, which is used to set the rates, needs to be reviewed?
Alistair Allard.
Well, I certainly don't claim that the system we have at the moment is perfection, but I also think we should celebrate the fact that local authorities are paying attractive rates, are running effective childcare across the country. I think that the funding agreement between the Scottish Government and COSLA does allow local authorities to pay sustainable rates at a level that enables both private and third sector services to pay at least the real living wage to staff delivering funded ELC, and that is something that should be marked, something that should be noted in its own right. I want to conclude soon, but I do want to say that the Scottish Government investment in childcare staffing numbers has risen from 33,000 to 38,000 over the last 5 years. And however, as is the case in many sectors, recruitment and retention of staff does, I would certainly acknowledge, continue to pose a challenge, not least partly as the result of Brexit, it must be said. But I can point in my own constituency, I would acknowledge, to examples of problems created by staffing shortages. For instance, I can think of a private nursery provider in my own constituency which recently had to abruptly close one of its rooms just before Christmas, and the local authority has worked hard to find spaces for all the displaced 3 to 5 year olds at short notice. However, parents there, as in I would accept this is true in other places too, have understandable concerns about that ongoing situation, not least because there are no alternative provision
for Dr.
children
Allen,
under two in their area. And on that note, I will conclude, Presiding Officer.
Thank you. I now call Ros McCall to be followed by Martin Whitfield. Speeches of up to 4 minutes, please, Ms. McCall.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. When the First Minister announced the 11/40 hours scheme, she was at Fallon Nursery in Stirling, and she said, "All children deserve the best start in life. Providing access to free, high-quality early learning and childcare enriches children's early years and provides them with skills and confidence for starting school and beyond, and it also supports parents' ability to work, train or study." The then COSLA Children and Young Persons spokesperson, Stephen McCabe, Councillor Stephen McCabe, said of the programme, "These additional hours will be transformative for families, ensuring children have more time to play and learn, while parents and carers have more opportunities to work, study and volunteer." I mention this because the ethos behind the programme was not only to provide government-funded childcare for under five-year-olds, but to allow parents and caregivers to have time for themselves, and I think in most cases they would use that to return to work. I would go so far as to say for the 11/40 hours scheme to work properly, it had to make sure that it met the needs of working parents and allow them to do just that. So let's look at that. Most working parents commute to work. Fallon Nursery, the same one the First Minister attended, opens at 8 o'clock in the morning. And if you live in the Stirling area and work in Edinburgh, you need to catch the 7:29 train to guarantee to get to work for 9. Coming home, it's the same, catching the 5:33 from Waverley, which arrives in Stirling well after 6, which is the time when the nursery closes. And that's assuming that the trains are actually running or on time. A simple blend of childminder to top up and tail the nursery offer would be perfect, but that's a blend that's proving problematic. We've heard from my colleague Megan Gallagher about the issues facing the private nurseries, but childminding offer is also in sharp decline. It's under threat too. The Scottish Government's own Childminding Workforce Trends 2022 comes up with the following points. One, the childminding workforce has declined by 28% in Scotland between 2014 and 2020. Two, the annual decreases of childminders has been accelerating since 2017. Three, the proportion of childminders over the age of 55 has steadily increased, 24% in 2020 when it was 11% in 2010. Four, a quarter of respondents to the Scottish Childminding Association 2020 members survey said they were unlikely to be childminding in 5 years' time. Five, the process of becoming a childminder was generally viewed as time-consuming and overly bureaucratic. Six, on pay. The amount of administration required was seen as exasperating the low pay issue because of the longer hours it requires on childminders. I could go on, but I only have 4 minutes. Nevertheless, in itself, it's quite a damning list. What's the point of the Follow the Child funding programme when blended childcare is becoming limited at best? I would also state that the current level of funding is insufficient to work in this situation, but that's an entirely different debate. I look at the decline highlighted by both the NDNA and the Scottish Childminders Association. Nursery staffing in crisis, childminding in crisis, the wage disparity, the on-costs, the administration and bureaucracy. We are rapidly heading towards no offer at all. And let's be honest, that can't help but reduce the 87% that's already been mentioned here today. A mix of childminder, private and public offers is imperative to fit in with the needs of the family, as well as the children that this is meant to provide for. Setting up a nuanced mix of what's available so your child becomes settled, safe and secure within their time away from their parents is fundamental. And if we don't sort out this, the objective of the 1140 hours will fail. It will fail to provide for working parents. It will fail to provide for rural nurseries. It will fail to provide for childminders. But most of all, it will fail to provide for all children, and that cannot be allowed to happen.
Thank you, Ms McCall. I now call Martin Whitfield to be followed by Willie Rennie. Up to 4 minutes, please, Mr Whitfield.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer, and it's a pleasure to follow Ros McCall in this debate. And can I too extend my thanks to Megan Gallagher for securing this very important debate. When we discuss the future of childcare, it's important to acknowledge that this is an issue that disproportionately affects women. The lack of childcare, specifically affordable and flexible childcare, stops many women from working, studying, training. And it is also inherently a woman's issue in that 95% of the ELC workforce are, of course, women. If we want to support women back to work, if we want to support the women into our workforce, we must address the issue of childcare. I, like many across this chamber, welcome the introduction of the 1140 hours of funded childcare. However, as Poverty Alliance have pointed out, this entitlement must be viewed as a starting point rather than an end point of reform. And can I take this opportunity to thank the Minister for a meeting that we had recently regarding a number of matters regarding ELC, and I want to touch on a couple of those, hopefully to invite the Minister to put on the record some of the responses that were received. The first we've already mentioned, which is the relationship between our local authority nurseries and private sector nurseries. It is true that there is a tension across many local authorities between those two services, and there needs to be work done to facilitate a meeting of minds, a meeting of understanding, so that it's our young people that can be properly served through this early years. And I do feel that the Scottish Government can make a more positive contribution to facilitating those discussions. One of the areas we talked about, please do.
Minister.
Thank you, and I thank Martin Whitfield for taking my intervention. And the Scottish Government has worked very closely with COSLA, because we wouldn't have been able to deliver the 1140 rollout without the work with COSLA and with the PVI sector. So what would he suggest that the Scottish Government do over and above what we've done already?
Martin Whitfield.
I'm very grateful, and it is to the credit of the Scottish Government and indeed COSLA that work has gone on between the two over the rollout of this, but it's also about that relationship with the private sector, many of whom rightly feel that they're excluded from committees, work parties, and indeed are excluded sometimes in contributing to the debate about early years. Now, how can that better be achieved? Well, the simple answer, I think, is to invite them into the circle, to be at the table when decisions are considered and made. I was going to go on to comment another specific area which the Minister may find useful, which is the challenge that private sector, and in particular when I talk about private sector, I'm talking about parents' groups and charity groups, in gaining access to local authority properties, particularly schools, particularly primary schools, to provide that wraparound care. There seems to be great challenges about getting access to these buildings, where indeed some of our early years children are during the day anyway, to be able to stay later into the evening to counter the travel challenges that we've already heard of. I realise that time is short, but I wonder whether the Minister would be able to also comment about constituents' concerns that have been raised with me with regard to catchment areas and the challenge both in the understanding of the fact that there isn't a catchment area for the purpose of nursery, but there is for P1, and indeed the reality of that situation and whether it is something the government is looking at. Because parents fail to understand why they can't go to the nursery attached to the primary school that their child will go to. And that in turn causes transition problems, because sometimes the nurseries that are being relied on in the private sector are too far away to hand on. In conclusion, you know, 90% of lone parents are women. And as long as we fail to fix these issues of early year provision, we are failing women up and down the country. Women who would, can be, and should be an invaluable asset. They are a huge loss to our economy. But we are also failing our young people at the most vulnerable time when they need the support, as we've heard, to transition into a successful education. The future of childcare needs to remain a priority for this Parliament, and we cannot assume that the 1140 hours has fixed it. We must not forget that it is women and children who sit at the centre of this debate. I'm grateful, Deputy Presiding Officer.
Thank you, Mr Whitfield. I now call Willie Rennie to be followed by Brian Whittle. Up to 4 minutes, please, Mr Rennie.
I want to thank Megan Gallagher for bringing forward this debate, and I hope that we manage to persuade the Minister that at least she accepts there is an issue here. I think the 1140 hours expansion is a great thing. I'm delighted to see that it's worked in many areas relatively smoothly, that it's given some flexibility, but it's certainly increased the hours. It's good. It's the best start in life for young people. We know that it can transform their opportunities. It really sets them on a good course for life. And it also gives parents the opportunity to get back to work. I all too well remember the real challenges of juggling the children from childminders into the nursery. So having the fully comprehensive wraparound support is important. So I want to give credit to the government for moving forward on the 1140 hours. But there is a real problem with the disparity of pay levels between the private and voluntary sector and the public sector. And it's built in. We've got a whole host of examples of people who are doing exactly the same job but are paid dramatically different rates of pay. In Falkirk, a local authority head of centre is paid 71% more than their private nursery manager. In Glasgow, a deputy head of nursery is paid 87% more than their equivalent in the private sector. North Lanarkshire, exactly the same. Now, I understand the responsibilities are different. That's the Minister's point, but they're not that different. The huge pay differentials are massive, and it's no wonder, therefore, we've got quite a significant movement of staff away from the private sector, sometimes to other jobs altogether, not in council nurseries. But the pay rates are just not sufficient, and I recognise...
Minister?
I thank Willie Rennie for doing that. You know, we must recognise that the childcare industry is a mixed economy, and the employers in the private and the third sector make business decisions, and they are responsible for those business decisions. And public funding only accounts for between 33 and 45% of the overall income of private childcare services.
Willie Rennie.
No, I accept that point, and in the past, that cross-subsidy was acceptable, because the proportion that the state was contributing to those nurseries' business was relatively small. Now it's huge, and there's a debate about how much the state is contributing towards those private nurseries. Some of them say it's 55%, but we can have a discussion about that. But it's certainly increased. So the ability to cross-subsidise is just not there to the same extent as it used to be. And why should private clients, why should parents pay for the inability of the state to pay for the staff properly that they are in the public sector? I don't think there should be the cross-subsidy to that extent, and it is to put all the pressure on the private clients, I think, is unacceptable. So we need to fix this. And I understand Matthew Sweeney, if I can just read, Matthew Sweeney actually revealed it all to the Education Committee back in May. He said, "We are being told by the Scottish Government that the funding that has been given to us is to allow private and voluntary partners, providers, to pay the real living wage. At the same time, funding for local authorities must be able to meet the nationally set rates through collective bargaining for our workforce." In a quote, that encapsulates the problem. The government has accepted, it's built into the system, it's baked in, that in private nurseries, we pay up to the national living wage, whilst council nurseries have nationally negotiated rates of pay. That's the problem. We're building it in. And I understand how it's happened, because that's private nurseries primarily were getting private income before, so they were setting their own pay rates. But now that the government is paying the majority, I would argue, of those private nurseries' income, it's building in that disparity. And no wonder, therefore, we've got an exodus of staff from the private sector. Now, I understand how we got there, but the minister has got to at least accept that we've got a problem and we need to try and fix it. We can't do it overnight. I accept that, because it's a massive amount of money we'd require. But we need to have a plan, at least, to close that gap to stop the exodus.
Thank you, Mr Rennie. I now call Brian Whittle to be followed by Faisal Chowdhury. Mr Whittle.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. Can I begin by thanking my colleague Megan Gallagher for bringing forward this debate? And can I also thank all the PVI sector nurseries for their continued updates and briefs on the rollout of 1,140 hours of childcare. Now, usually I look forward to speaking in these debates, but I have to say, Deputy Presiding Officer, this is hardly the first time we've had to bring the crisis in the PVI sector to this chamber. And I find myself frustrated and bewildered that after several years of debating this issue, we are still here bringing the same fears and concerns to the industry, to the Scottish Government. And it's strange, because we all support the premise of 1,140 hours of free childcare and the opportunities that that can bring in so many ways. This is not a debate about policy. This is the debate on the rollout and the implementation of that policy. It's about this debate is about the Scottish Government's continued refusal to accept there is a serious issue with the imbalance between public nurseries and the PVI sector. And you can't hide from these facts anymore. Now, I accept the pandemic has been a major inhibitor to the rollout of free childcare, and I imagine we all agree on that. But it should have given the Scottish Government the time to consider the issues previously raised on behalf of the sector in this chamber on many occasions from these benches and across the chamber. Specifically, this huge disparity that Willie Rennie talked about across the country of council relationships and the treatment of private nursery care, which in many cases was far from ideal. In speaking with a number of the private nurseries owners, it is clear there is a serious concern as to their treatment and the sustainability within this scheme, and that those issues remain. Now, I know the Minister will have examples where the attitude and approach of local councils is collaborative and reflects the way in which the Scottish Government has set out its delivery plan, but there seems to have been little progress with ensuring that the picture across the country is uniform. I listen to stories of local authorities who have openly stated that they do not believe in private nursery childcare and have the intention of bringing all childcare in-house, with no intention of partnering with private childcare nurseries. Of course.
Minister.
What Mr Whittle is saying here, or alleging here, is very concerning. And if he has evidence of this, I would be more than happy to receive correspondence from him on the matter.
Brian Whittle.
Can I thank the Minister for intervention? Can I say to the Minister that those concerns were raised with the previous Minister, and I will forward you on those particular cases, and that still pervades, unfortunately, across certain council areas. Now, as I said, these have no intention of partnering with private childcare nurseries, nurseries which have delivered decades of top quality care, who have become an integral part of their communities. Every nursery represented highlighted the issue of local authorities recruiting directly from the partnership nurseries into local authority nurseries. They are losing so many highly trained, qualified staff that the care inspectorate are downgrading them because of an increasing turnover of staff. We have local authorities able to pay a higher rate for apprentices than the partnership nurseries can for qualified staff. Yet local authorities are asking the partnership nurseries to train their apprentices. So we have a ludicrous situation where apprentices are being paid more than those who are training them. That's not a partnership. Deputy Presiding Officer, there are huge discrepancies between what the Minister has asked local authorities to deliver and what some of them are delivering. There are local authorities who are consulting and treating partnership nurseries as a crucial part of the scaling up of childcare in Scotland. However, as I've tried to highlight today, there are a significant number who are treating them as anything but partners, to the point where many are under threat. The fact that there is, in many cases, local authorities are in essence setting themselves up in competition with the partnership nurseries according to those partnerships. For the Minister to deliver this crucial policy, she will need all of those partnership nurseries. The truth is she's in danger of losing them and all their years of experience in dedicated care in her communities. And once they are lost, it will be next to impossible to get them back again, Deputy Presiding Officer.
Thank you, Mr Whitto. I call Faisal Chowdhury to be followed by Fulton McGregor.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. I would like to thank Megan Gallagher for bringing this business in the Chamber. In November, I met with Graham McAllister, CEO for the Scottish Childminding Association, who raised some very important issues surrounding the future and welfare of childminders in Scotland. The childminding workforce in Scotland has now declined by 30%, and with that, the loss of over 10,000 childminding places for families. As places drop and the cost of childcare rise, many families find themselves either unable to afford childcare or unable to find it. We cannot allow this to continue. There is currently not enough support offered to the childminding workforce in Scotland, and the sector is under pressure with a lack of trained professionals available to fill much-needed positions. Childminding is a vital and valuable industry, but the childminding workforce requires significant support to carry it through this decline. Many of the workforce are reporting that delivering the funded early learning and childcare hours has caused a significant increase in paperwork. This has resulted in many childminders undertaking an additional 5+ hours of unpaid paperwork each week, resulting in a loss of focus on the child. As a result, childminders who were previously providing funded childcare hours are chasing to do so because of an unsustainable amount of paperwork. Funded childcare hours must continue, but the Scottish Government need to ensure they are supporting the workforce to do so. What is even more alarming is that 60% of those surveyed believed they would have to reduce the heating setting this winter when children are present in their homes. It is shocking that some are considering switching off their heating when their family are present to be able to heat their sitting when it is open for their childminding business during the day. I particularly want my colleagues to be aware that only 13% of childminders believe they can pay themselves the living wage, with almost all participants reporting that they work extra hours unpaid every week. This is a deeply concerning statistic. The impact of the COVID-19 pandemic and the cost of living crisis has put this vital industry at risk. And it is time for the Scottish Government to recognise the acute pressure facing the childminding workforce in Scotland. Underpaying And overworking is never going to allow this integral sector to flourish. The Scottish Government must now take measures to encourage and support the much-needed recruitment of childminders and demonstrate that it values Scotland's children and the dedicated workers who care for them daily. Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer.
Thank you, Mr. Chowdhury. And I now call Fulls McGregor, who will be the last speaker before I ask the Minister to respond. Mr. McGregor.
Thank you. Pardon me. Thank you, Presiding Officer, and thank you for allowing me to speak. It wasn't initially my intention. I want to thank Megan Gallagher as well for bringing the debate to the Chamber. I might not take up the whole 4 minutes, Presiding Officer. I'm sure you'll be glad to hear. But as the Minister will know, I've had a bit of input in this area as well, and I've been contacted by PVI sector nurseries in my own Coatbridge and Creyson constituency, some I think who have also reached out to Megan Gallagher. And I think that they have expressed some concerns about the current situation and the hours. And I know that some of those, as have been expressed by Megan Gallagher, do relate to pay, but also we've had concerns, as we've talked about in the earlier debates today, around the cost of living crisis. And I think all of this is certainly coming together. One of the private nurseries that I'll mention in Coatbridge is Kirkton Home Nursery, and I'll declare an interest. My daughter goes there one day a week, an absolutely fantastic nursery. I'm sure that they would love to have the Minister out for a visit to the Forest School, if she was inclined at any point. I have done that visit as well as having the wee one there, and it's really good, as is Parkview Nursery, also within my constituency. So really, really good work going on there. And I have to say, I do agree with what other speakers have said today. I do think we are in a wee bit of a difficult position if workers in these nurseries are getting paid significantly less than those in the local authority sectors, because they're doing a fantastic job. They really are. And I know that it's not the case across the board, as Billy Rennie said, but certainly as it does seem to be the case in North Lanarkshire. And don't get me wrong, in North Lanarkshire, and I'm sure Megan Gallagher will agree, there's some absolutely excellent local authority nurseries. The Stepping Stones, for example, and also the Tolbrae Sclerari Nursery, where my middle child went, and it's a Gaelic nursery, absolutely fantastic. So I do think that overall 1,140 hours is very much a major success. But what it feels like to me when I've been dealing with the private nurseries who have came to me for a bit of support, and I think they've all, more or less, all the ones in my constituency, have approached me at one time or another, either collectively or individually, is it feels as if there's a bit of a standoff there just now. The local authority nurseries are really moving forward with pace. They've been able to pay their staff really, really good wages, something that Scotland we can be proud of. I'm sure the Minister is really proud of that. But the system which is in place is meaning the PVI sector is falling behind. Staff are leaving, as we've heard already. And I wonder if there's some sort of way we can have both. And we can try and get to that. So, as I said, I hadn't actually prepared a speech as such, Presiding Officer. I just decided to speak during the debate. So I really just wanted to end with a couple of asks. One for the member, Megan Gallagher. I know that she'll be up for this, but before the legal dispute, or whatever you want to call it, in North Lanarkshire happened, there was going to be a meeting between MSPs of all parties and the private nursery sector. And I know that the lead, if you like, Ms Leggett, did contact us to say, because of a letter they'd received from the local authority, pardon me, they were no longer able to have that meeting. So I wonder if, when the time is right and any proceedings, whatever they may be, are elapsed, we could have that meeting. And I see Megan nodding to that, and I'd be happy to do that as well on a cross-party basis locally. But also, if the Minister, I wonder, just as Billy Rennie and others have asked, if she can take another look at this. I think the 1140 hours is an excellent policy. It's working really well, but there is something which I'm picking up as a constituency MSP that's not going completely right with the PVI sector. I wonder if she can look at that, whether on a national basis or whether it's maybe sporadically across the country, and see if there is solutions to it. I heard the funding formula might be one way to look at it, or reviewing that, I'm not sure. But I just would ask the Minister, in summing up, if she would consider that. And Thank you very much, Presiding Officer. Again,
thank you, Mr. McGregor. I now call on Minister Clay Hockey to respond to the debate. Up to 7 minutes, please, Minister.
Thank you very much, Presiding Officer. And this has been an important debate today, and I think it's critical that we put on record the significant collective achievement of delivering 1140 and thank our partners in local government, the private, third and childminding sectors again for all their hard work in making such a success of the expansion so far. I'm particularly proud that this offer is available to all eligible children, regardless of their parents' working status, meaning that Scotland has the most generous childcare offer in the UK today. And I will continue to make the case that children's needs must always come first. It's testament to the efforts of everyone in this sector that we now have near universal uptake amongst 3- and 4-year-olds, 99% in the latest published statistics. And it's also good news that the number of 2-year-olds registering for funded ELC is at the highest ever level. And I'm pleased that we have secured a legal gateway with the United Kingdom government, which finally means that local authorities in Scotland will be able to access the information that they need to contact eligible households later this year. This will make a real difference to levels of uptake, and my officials are working closely with councils to support them to reach as many families as possible. I'm also delighted to read the positive experiences that families are having with funded ELC. Quality and flexibility are at the heart of our 1140 offer, and survey results published in December show that we are delivering for families. 97% of parents are satisfied with the quality of the funded hours their children access, and over 88% of parents are satisfied that they have the flexibility to use their funded hours in a way that works for them. There has been discussion today about rates paid to providers, and I want to reiterate that throughout the 1140 expansion, we have used the significant public investment that we have made in funded ELC, almost £1 billion in 2023-24, to seek to support and improve conditions across the private, voluntary and childminding workforce that delivers this vital service. Yes, of course.
Megan Gallagher.
I thank the Minister for giving way. We do all agree in the principle of 1140. I think that's something that's universally accepted amongst all political parties. But I do need to ask, will you agree to fix the rate system for the PVI sector today? That is a huge ask, and it would make a huge difference to the PVI sector as we continue to roll out 1140 hours.
Minister.
So, I hear what the member is saying, but I don't accept the premise that ELC is failing in the way that she describes or that it is in crisis. Scotland is the only part of the UK to have made a commitment to paying staff the real living wage for the delivery of funded ELC, and we've made real progress there. Before the expansion, approximately 80% of staff delivering funded ELC in the private and third sectors were paid less than the living wage. In contrast, in 2021, Health Check indicated that 88% of private providers intended to pay the real living wage to all their staff from August 2021. And our investment in sustainable rates is also critical to enabling employers to pay the real living wage to professionals delivering funded ELC and to ensuring the quality and sustainability of provision. As a result of the ELC expansion, average rates paid to providers to deliver funded ELC to 3- to 4-year-olds have increased by 57% since 2017. The average rate paid for 3- to 4-year-olds by Scottish local authorities is the highest in the UK in 2023-24 at £5.77 per hour, compared to £5 per hour in Wales and £5.15 in England. I think Mr Rennie was wanting in.
Willie Rennie? Yeah,
I accept that. The rates in Scotland are higher than in England. I accept that. I accept that the real living wage is an advance on what was being done before. But the disparity is causing a problem. And I hope the Minister, and I've heard her talking about this before in the committee, but I hope the Minister is going to accept that that disparity is causing a problem. We are having nurseries closing and rooms closing, and we need the PVI sector for the flexibility that parents are desperately needing. So I hope the Minister, I understand all the arguments she's making, but she's got to accept there is a problem.
Minister.
I thank Willie Rennie for his intervention. This is something that we did debate in committee, and I can't remember if at the time when he had raised this issue, if I referenced the ELC census, the most recent one of which was published in December, and there, where, when he talked about a reduction of services providing funded ELC, that there was a 1% reduction in services providing ELC. So not the, the closure or mass closure that some may herald. I'm not accusing Mr. Rennie of that. I appreciate that conditions are challenging for providers, particularly as a result of the pandemic and the cost crisis. And that's why we're continuing the nursery rates relief scheme, providing 100% relief on non-domestic rates to eligible day nurseries beyond the 30th of June this year. And it's worth noting, Presiding Officer, that the temporary nursery discount on rates in England ended on the 1st of April last year. We are also developing a programme of tailored support to enable childcare providers to access specialist advice on strengthening and diversifying their businesses. And I would like to take a moment to recognise the unique and invaluable role that Childminders play that Mr Chowdhury was speaking about in delivering high quality funded ELC. And although recent years have been challenging for Childminders, we continue to work closely with our partners, including the Scottish Childminding Association, to increase the number of Childminders in Scotland through the implementation of our Commitment to Childminding report.
Ross McCall.
Thank you. The number of Childminders in Scotland has actually fallen from 6,752 in 2012 to 4,829 in 2021. So does the member accept that should childminders continue to decline in this way, there actually won't be a childminding sector left?
Minister.
I thank the member for her intervention, and I was about to come on to the work that we're actually doing to promote childminding and to increase recruitment to childminding. I think it's an absolute fact. I absolutely accept that there has been a drop in the number of childminders in Scotland. That's replicated across the UK. It's not unique to Scotland. So what we are doing is we are working with the Childminding Association. That work includes supporting the delivery of targeted recruitment models, such as the innovative Scottish Rural Childminding Partnership, which aims to recruit and train 100 new childminders in remote and rural areas. And indeed, we are funding an extension of the recruitment pilot into urban areas. And we've also recently committed to funding a new pilot to provide targeted support to childminders to help them streamline the administrative burdens associated with their practice. If I can just respond to a point that Mr Whitfield made about engagement with the sector. In fact, tomorrow, the Childcare Sector Working Group will meet with representatives from across the PVI Local Authority and Scottish Childminding Association. And we're establishing a new national Childcare Providers Forum, which will be a space for strategic policy discussion. And we're keen to have as wide a representation of the sector as possible there. And we're also funding the Scottish Childcare Sector Representation and Sustainability Fund of up to £500,000 over the next 2 years to support eligible childcare sector representative bodies to deliver their representative functions, because that is key. We need to hear their voice and to strengthen their long-term sustainability. In conclusion, Presiding Officer, these are really strong foundations for us to build on, and I look forward to continuing to work closely with COSLA and our partners in the sector to deliver the new legislation on deferrals from August and on other priorities, including continuing to deliver progress on sustainable rates and the uptake of the two-year-old offer. And I'm also looking forward to continuing our work on building a new system of school-aged childcare and developing the evidence around expanding ELC for 1 and 2 year olds, delivering on our ambitious commitment for Scotland's children and families.
Thank you, Minister. That concludes the debate, and I close this meeting.